Oh, it's a busy year. A couple of films out. Now, tell me about Swing, first of all. So it's about the setting up of a band, basically, isn't it?
Yes, it is. It's about Martin, who is my son, played by Hugo Speer, who's just coming out of prison at the beginning of the film. And while he's in prison, he learns how to play the saxophone. And it's really how, when he comes out, he starts to form a band. And he asked his ex-girlfriend to be the singer of the band, and really it's that. It's a comedy, a romantic comedy.
So where's it all set?
In Liverpool.
In Liverpool itself.
Where else?
Where else? And the other one, which is called Out of Depth, here again you actually play a mother of a son who's in prison. Sean Maguire, of course, from EastEnders. Was he excited about making a film?
Very, yeah. And he was wonderful to work with. He's very focused and very professional. And we spent a couple of days before we started shooting getting to know each other, like, you know, so that there would be some kind of relationship, mother and son. And it was wonderful. Tough film to make. We didn't have much money to make it. We made it in 5 weeks, long hours. But I feel it's a very strong film.
Yes, I say it's got a very, very tough edge to it.
It's based on a true story about this young boy who finds out that his mother, who the character I play, is beaten up when she's leaving her job of work. She works in a pub. And he decides he's going to take care of the person that did that. And he's advised not to, but someone said they will help him. And really, from the beating up of the mother, everyone's sort of characters spiral downwards. And he gets drawn into the wrong company. He gets sort of caught in carrying drugs and things like that. And he ends up in prison. It is a true story. I won't tell you the ending, but it's a very sad story.
No, I never like to know the endings in advance. But actually, I was reading that it was very well received in Cannes at the film festival when it was shown there, which reminded me in turn, some years back, about 1962, I guess, when you were really the flavour of the year. It was fantastic because you won the Best Actress that year, didn't you?
Yes, I did. But I won it, but I've never seen it. I don't know who's got it or whether they've sort of put their name in or whatever it is, but I've never seen it to this day.
So you won it for A Taste of Honey and you never actually got the trophy?
No, but that happened with quite a few awards I was given. People would go along, because in those days they didn't pay for you to go, you see, to receive your award. And people sort of accepted it on your behalf and probably put it on their shelf.
It's a point of interest. Why were you not there to collect it yourself?
They didn't ask me to go back and I couldn't afford to fly there.
No. Had you any idea when you were making that movie, A Taste of Honey, that it would be as groundbreaking as it turned out to be?
It just felt good, but really only after the fact do you realise what it means. When you go to make your next film, they're saying, oh, well, let's hope this is as good as the last one. That's when you realise what it means.
Mind you, I stood you in good stead all these years, and I know you have been busy, you know, whether you were living in Canada or whatever you were doing, but it's fantastic when you make a movie of that standard and it just stays with you. People are very loyal because of it.
Yeah, and I think it was a groundbreaking film too, and it was a very a story that hadn't been touched before, really. The 60s started making films about people that they could relate to rather than something. I mean, there were many wonderful films made, but it was what they called, which I don't really like the name of, the kitchen sink and realism.
Well, I think you like a little touch of grittiness, and you also always speak very fondly of Liverpool, because I think you always feel it's got an edge there as well. So what was your growing up period like?
Very ordinary. My dad had a shop, grocer's shop, and I used to go and help him in the shop, stacking the shelves. He used to put things, because I was very tiny.
Still, it's like a corner shop?
Yes, corner shop and post office, and I used to deliver the orders with him, and I used to play football with my brothers and things like that. And I went to a convent school, La Sagesse Convent. I went there because I was going to go to another school, but I was run over when I was seven.
Oh, well, that badly.
I tell people cross the road when that little red man said, don't do it, wait for the green man. Anyway, I was run over completely, and my parents said, well, we can't send you to that school, you must go to this school. And the reasoning was that I wouldn't have too many roads to cross. But the only road I had to cross was the one I was run over on.
No.
It's crazy. That's Liverpool logic, you know.
Problem child, I think. Were your parents interested in theatre? Is that how you became fascinated?
Yes, my mother used to go to Liverpool Rep to every play. And she took me along. The first play I saw, I think, was Peter Pan, which I loved. It was so magical. I mean, you can remember, can't you, going to see Peter Pan?
Oh, yes.
And seeing this person flying and coming through those windows and everything. And that's really... But I always wanted to act, but that really hooked me.
And actually, you were talking about football en route, you know, played football in and around the streets and so on. Yeah. And of course, your very latest project, which will make you a director in this case,
yeah,
is all to do with football, yes, women's football.
It is. It's a true story about the Dick Kerr ladies who, during the First World War, these women worked in the munitions factory, on the buses, any jobs that the men used to do because the men were away at war. And they formed a football team. And they were...
So this was like a factory team, was it?
Yes, it was. But nurses played in it as well. And they were hugely successful. So successful that after the war, the FA banned them from playing on professional grounds.
Well, in fact, we're going to talk to one of the players later on who we managed to track down.
Yeah.
But when you read the book about this particular team, how did you get it off the ground as a project?
I took it to Bill Kenwright, who, as you know, is a Liverpoolian, but supports Everton and is a fanatical
managing
football
director
fan.
Or whatever.
Yes, exactly. And I took it to him, and I've known Bill for many, many years. And I took it to him and I said, have a look at that. I thought, just look at the back. And he looked at the back and it said about the girls, and it said Goodison Park, which of course is his first love. And he said, oh, I want to do it. And he gave me development money and we're writing the script, and he's been incredibly, incredibly supportive. And
so you're going to be completely submerged in football?
Yes, but I love that, because my father used to take me to Everton when I was knee-high. In Liverpool, that's what it is. It's religion and football.
In that order?
Not
necessarily. Well, I know that you're going to enjoy some conversations coming up, but for the moment, Rita Tushingham, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Well, I must say again, this whole story sounds absolutely and completely fascinating. How did you get involved yourself in the history of it?
I come from Preston. Dick Kerr ladies are a legend up there. And being, always having played football when I was a little girl, you know, out in the street with the lads. And people used to say, you should be playing for this Dick Kerr ladies. So you're always aware of this women's football team, but I obviously never saw them.
And you were born, I think, quite near the factory, were you?
Yeah, just a stone's throw, yeah.
So it was all legendary in your time.
In fact, I went to school near the place as well, and some of the pioneers who played at the beginning, I probably passed them in the street and didn't even know.
Now, as a point of interest, when is it logged that the very first ladies' football game as such took place?
The first official game took place in 1895 in London. Between the north and south of London, a lady called Nettie Honeyball got the ball rolling, so to speak. And obviously, obviously way ahead of her time. And she organised this game and didn't see any reason why women shouldn't play a manly game but look ladylike as well.
Absolutely. Mm. I mean, isn't it unbelievable in a way that so many turned out then for women's football?
Yeah. Mm. I don't know why they don't do it today. There's this attitude now, and I think it's a throwback to 1921 when the FA did ban the women's football.
Well, of course, not that June was around in 1921 to play. When did you actually join, June?
1950. Coming up to 51.
But you, of course, would have known all about the FA ban.
Oh, yes. That happened in 1921.
So you weren't allowed to play in any of the official grounds, I take it?
No,
where did you play your football?
Rugby grounds, any place, really, that could be mapped out big enough for a football match to be played on. In actual fact, I've been to a field where they've been actually marking out the lines where we would play.
And how did you get hooked? I mean, because you had brothers who hated football, apparently.
I had one brother and he hated football, yeah. And he could never understand why I always wanted to get the ball, go up on the park and have a kick about. He didn't do anything, basically. Perhaps he did things like birds nesting and things like that. But that was about.
So who introduced you to this famous team?
It was my mum, actually. She saw a little article in the Lancashire Evening Post, and it was a Mr. Franklin, and he wanted lady football players to be signed on. So there was a telephone number there, and she said, go for it. And I said, oh, no, really, you know, I can't do that. And my father saying in the background, shouldn't be playing football, it's not a ladies' game, you know.
Was it actually very much frowned upon, do you think, by many people?
They said that it wasn't a ladies' game, but I enjoyed it. I mean, I loved it, you know, having a kick about. The boys used to come and knock on the front door and say, Junior, come in, you know, on the park. We're one short in our team.
So you were the goalie?
Yes, I was the goalie.
And I gather you lost an awful lot of your precious memoir and
yes,
belongings,
I did, yeah.
And all
but,
of that. What happened? You were burnt in a fire or something?
Yeah, we had a fire at home, and it was done through a cigarette being put down the side of the
shame.
And I was 18, and I lost everything. I had a bedroom full of pictures, really, that had come from various people down there clicking away.
I mean, do you feel, Rita, that it's such a special era when these women were playing their football and keen to play?
Well, yes, it was. It's not just about that, though. It's about them sort of having to work to do the men's jobs, keeping a home going, and also playing football and doing everything, encompassing everything. I think women are able to do that. Men are not able to do that. And that was their bravery and their courage.
So do you think, in a way, it was a backlash, with the time of the war, when men went away, women were having to work anyway in terms of what had to be done during the war? Was this part of their release, do you think?
Well, yeah, they wanted to play. I mean, they were working hard in the factory all week, and they were, the initial thing was a patriotic gesture from playing football. But once they'd started doing it, they realised that they enjoyed it. And why the hell shouldn't they play?
And obviously they built up a good standard with lot of people coming to see them. So why then did the FA ban them?
Well, basically they obviously were frightened of the competition. Dick Kerr's were attracting crowds of, Goodison Park, Boxing Day 1920, 53,000 people come along to watch a women's football team. Well, the alarm bells started to ring, didn't they? And, in the end, it wasn't safe for women to play football.
And I know that you toured. In fact, where does it? This relates to France, doesn't it? I don't know whether. Yeah. Did you go to France at all, June?
No.
Where did you go to?
I played the French team, but they came over here.
They came to you?
Yeah,
absolutely.
And who do these boots belong to?
These boots belong to Lily Parr. Now, this woman is an absolute legend, I tell you. She just. Obviously, I never met the lady. She passed on before. But she just oozes out. And these
actually, they're in great condition. Yeah,
there's still some mud on from probably her last year, a bit of old grass there too. But these are reputedly what Lily wore when they went to America in 1922.
No.
Yeah. And you can see she's left-footed, was Lily. And obviously, she's...
And some of these great medals.
Well, this one is from 1917. That's going back to the beginning. This one is from 1920-21, and this one here is 1937. They played a championship of the world match, and they were all presented with these gold medals, and they had a victory dinner afterwards, and this was the table setting with the menu, and everyone was around. So,
how did you acquire all the memorabilia?
I've just been lucky, really. Joan Worley, God rest her, was a very special lady who played for the team. She gave me some of the medals. That one was picked up at a car boot sale, and they gave it to someone. Gave it to Joan, who passed it on to me.
So the team wound up then in the 60s. Why was that?
I think everything has a life, and they just sort of like come to the end. And all the stalwart players like Joan Worley, Joan Burke, and some of the ones who have been around for a long time, they were past the sell-by date, and there wasn't the amount of people wanting to play. But in 1966, England won the World Cup, and then the whole country wanted to play.
Of course.
And then it had a resurgence, but...
Well, I'm sure, June, it stands out in your mind as being one of the most exciting periods of your life.
Oh, wonderful. It took me into a different world. I'd do it all again tomorrow.
Would you? Well, at least you will be able to relive it through Rita's film. It sounds a fascinating story for a film, and I'm sure it's going to be a great success. When do you reckon it actually will be out?
Well, we've got to get the script right, but and then the money.
It'll be like 2 years,
I suppose. Yes, probably, but just keep your fingers crossed for it, because it's such a wonderful story.
It is a wonderful story, and thank you very much indeed for bringing it to our house. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.